It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn bustos into robustos. Brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker. And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tehan.
Hey guys, how's it going?
Hi. Hey, what's up, guys?
Hi, Debbie. So this is Cash Play, our third show since we reinvented the show on Quad Jacks, brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker and use promo code QuadJacks82 for a free day trial and take your poker game to a new level. So, Joe, what's been going on with you lately?
Same old lately. Played a few days of poker this week, a few days of golf. That's about how my life's been going.
Yeah, typical life of a poker player.
Yeah.
One thing I want to mention, so these guys stop making fun of me, the guys over at Quad Jacks via Twitter or Facebook, whatever, is the background where I'm sitting. My computer is just set up on a desk, and Jill knows this because he's been here before, is the windows right behind. They keep making fun of me because I sit so close to the damn window. That's just the way how my desktop, my 30-inch, and my two side 20 inches are, just because I used to be an online grinder and it's just set up this way.
In your defense, it was a really cool looking online setup. Like, if you can only turn the camera around and show everyone, but it's a really cool online setup. So
at least I can't help the fact that there's a big window right behind my head. So you guys can stop making fun of me for that, Marco and Zach. So back to poker, you have a baby, or not poker, but Joe, you have a child soon on the way. Congratulations on that. Any day now, first kid.
Yeah.
So, and I was saying this before, make sure he's not born on the 15th of April.
I mean, he might be.
That's tax day, and we all have to pay our taxes, even as professional poker players.
Just in time for a write-off.
Exactly. But back to poker. I played a live tournament over the weekend at MGM Grand. One of our friends was running a poker tournament. It was a 350 buy-in, and I ended up making the final table. I was chip leader six-handed, feeling good, and felt like tournaments are easy. Poker always seems easy when you do well, obviously. And I was feeling like I'm about to take down this bitch. And chip leader, and then I run ace king into aces pre-flop and become short, and I bust out in fifth place, win a couple of thousand. And I was talking to you after that, and like, man, freaking tournaments, man, they feel like a real job, like a total grind, playing live tournaments. I mean, I played probably a total of close to 18 to 20 hours over the weekend, won $2,000. I mean, that's nothing to sneeze at, you know, it's still a pretty decent amount of change, but I just wanted to ask you, like, you play a lot more live tournaments than I do. Like, how do you handle the grind and all the hours you have to put in? And sometimes you have nothing to show for it.
Oh, man. I mean, I really, like, I don't know how a lot of these guys just do it every day. Like, when they would do it online, literally every day of the week they would play. When I go during the World Series of Poker, it's like 1 month long of pretty much tournament after tournament. And they are so, so depressing. I mean, because, like, you're never happy. You never win. I mean, it's just, and it sucks. And you want to, like, tell someone a bad beat story, and you're just like, who cares? It's, you know, it doesn't matter anyways. But it's like every single day, it's like, it's really depressing. I mean, so you have to kind of just enjoy. If you kind of enjoy it and say, hey, I'm going to lose this money. And, I mean, that's kind of how I approach it. I'm going to lose this buy-in, but whatever, if I get lucky or if I run good, maybe I'll run it up.
What, you go into a tournament expecting to lose?
I mean, pretty much.
Realistically, that's what happens most of the time, but come on, that's not the most optimistic.
No. I mean, most people say, oh, yeah, you should go in expecting to win. It's like, I go in, you know, realistically thinking, okay, well, I'm only probably going to make the money in this tournament, like, whatever, less than 20% of the time or whatever. So Or if they, I don't know how often I'm going to make the money. But like, so I'm just thinking, oh, 80% of the time I'm probably going to lose in this thing.
You know, there's this great mental game coach named Jared Tendler who could probably change your approach. Someone actually, I want to thank I Am the Greek for suggesting that. So you might want to get a session with him or two. He's actually very good, believe it or not.
I don't, it's not like I play any differently. I mean, come on. I still play the same. It's
I know. I mean, even though I kind of disagree with your approach just when you go into a tournament, but I mean, you can't argue with your results. So, but I know when you're actually playing, it's not like your mentality, that mentality affects your decision making. So,
but
you're just speaking the harsh reality of poker. Like you
said,
I think
that's more what it is. It's just,
I'm
just being very realistic with my chances.
Stating the facts. Yeah, I know that. But I'm just saying, in anything, we should try to be optimistic. But yeah, you're just stating the obvious facts that most of the time we're just going to bust out. So I guess what you're doing is trying to kind of lower the pain of busting out because you kind of expected
pretty much. Yeah, then you'll never be disappointed. I mean, I guess if you're not really expecting much, then you won't be disappointed.
Well, there you go. Now I understand why you're thinking. So, but it definitely makes sense. Some people go into tournaments hoping to win, expecting to win. And when you see it in the World Series of Poker coverage, the main event.
Yeah.
How they overreact when they bust out, you know, cursing, slamming, you know, slamming their hats into the table and things like that. So I guess if they had your mentality, they wouldn't be like that. But then it wouldn't make
sense. I mean, I still tilt just like the next guy.
So,
yeah.
Right. Well, enough about tournaments. So, one last thing is the markups people charge. I can now understand why people charge 10 to 30, 40% markups because it does feel like work and the time invested and stuff like that. So,
yeah, I mean, if, you know, when I first started selling pieces of myself in tournaments, I would always sell pieces to John and, like I always sold it to you at even money, like, and it was just kind of like, well, this tournament's a little bit too big for me. I don't want to really play a 1K right now. So give me 300 for 30%. You know, you don't really think, well, oh, I should ask this guy for markup because I'm doing more, you know? So that's how it was. I mean, but that was like, what, 5 or 6 years ago. And then all of a sudden, like a few years ago, everyone just starts, you know, they want to charge markup to be bought into a tournament. Anywhere from like 1.1 to 1.4 or whatever it is. I mean, or even crazier. But like, I don't know. What do you think about it, JK?
I've been thinking about this, but after playing the weekend tournament, I do think markups are fair just because, like I was saying, tournaments, they feel like a lot of work. You sit there, and I was thinking, you know, the grind of playing a live tournament, I mean, 18, 20 hours over a two-day period, for some reason, I was totally taxed, like wiped out after when I busted. I don't think it was because of the fact that I busted either. I mean, it wasn't like I was playing for too much money. I think 9, 10K was for first. So, I mean, if it was something like 100K or more, then yeah, I'd feel a lot more depressed and frustrated. But playing for 10K, I mean, money is all relative, you know, but since we're baller, it's just like a drop in the bucket, I guess. I make win and lose that in one session, which I'll get to in a bit. So anyway, after the long grind, I was just thinking, man, I should get paid for just playing this tournament. It's freaking hard. So I kind of realized where the markups come from and why people ask for markup. I'm not like a full tournament grinder, so it's hard for me to relate to that before. But I can see where that's coming from. And I was telling you, I'm going to be charging like 50% markup during the World Series because it's freaking hard.
Yeah.
So whereas before, I used to think, why are pro tournament players charging markup? Isn't that their job? I mean, why should they get paid for grinding tournaments? That's their job, right? But now I've kind of come around and I can understand why people charge markups because it is a lot of work playing tournaments day in, day out. So
yeah.
But let's get to the what I was going to get into is winning 8,000-9,000 or losing 8,000-9,000. I was telling you I played a couple of days online since I still grind online from time to time.
Yeah.
And I ran 25 buy-ins below EV. Can you do you know what it's like to run 25 buyers below EV, Joe? I don't know. You haven't played that much online poker, but it's a crap load ton of buy-ins.
No, I know. That's pretty tough. And I don't know. You should maybe explain that in case, like, some people don't know what that means. I mean,
if you're a live poker player, you're probably not going to understand graphs and running below or above EV. I think we talked about Sklansky dollars before.
Yeah, this is a good term, a good reference for Sklansky dollars.
Well, I mean, online cash games measured in buy-ins. So, say an NL 1-2-0 limit game, the buy-in is 200, 100 BBs. So if you lose a whole stack, that's $200. That's considered a buy-in. So I was playing 1-2 and 2-4 mixture and lost 25 buy-ins for a total of, I don't know what I think the total came out to $6,000-$7,000, over a 2-day period. But the thing was, I ran below EV, based on numbers.
It's like, you know, your computer program that says, okay, you got in aces versus kings and you lost. So that means, you know, you really had 80-20 equity and so now you're like 80%.
If you put in $200, in theory, you're supposed to win $160.
It'd
be plus 160, but instead I ended up minus 200.
I lost. You're minus 320 in equity or whatever.
Yeah. So basically, and let's talk about aces. I had, I was losing a crap load ton of aces. And I actually went into my hold'em manager that's tracking software that tracks how you're doing online while you grind. And I looked at aces over when I was playing one session, and I had them 30 times, and I was stuck 400. And that's hard to do.
Yeah, well, this is an important thing that I think a lot of people can learn. Like, especially when I went through my own stats online, and I also looked at John's stats online, and you look at, like, how much money you've won with each hand. I mean, obviously, John's running bad, like, recently, but you look at how you can see a breakdown of how much money you have won with each hand, and you'll see, like, by a very, very wide margin, the answer is going to be aces. Like, you know, so it's always broken down in kings, and, you know, some people think, oh, Jack 10 suited is my favorite hand, and it's like, you know, you might be, like, losing with the hand or whatever.
Yeah, let's talk about that. That's a good topic, actually. The biggest money makers in hold'em. It's by far what you're saying. Aces by far. Nothing's even close. And then kings is a pretty big second favorite, too. And then there's a pretty big gap between kings and the next biggest one. I'm not sure if it's queens or ace-king.
It's probably queens.
Yeah, it is queens, actually. That's right. It's queens. And then ace-king is kind of a close fourth.
Yeah.
But it's funny when you ask when the whole question about what's your favorite poker hand, right? And people, I mean, at least 30-40%. That could be a general. That could be like a whatever, like a fair estimate. Maybe I don't know.
Believe me, when people think that four deuces is my favorite hand, I mean, I don't think I've ever played it once. Yeah, like,
if you're not answering aces as your favorite hand, consider yourself a poker donkey. I'm serious. If you're not answering aces.
I mean, I have a lot of hands that I, like, have sentiment for that have, you know, helped me get lucky in a big tournament or whatever. But, I mean, if anyone asks me what my favorite hand is, like, I don't even think about those. I think I like aces.
Yeah, like, I can understand what you're saying. If you won, like, a major tournament, like the final Jack 10 off or whatever, or in your case, 8-9 off, I still remember when you won the Mandalay Bay. I mean, you can kind of have a sentimental attachment to that and say, yeah, that's my favorite hand because, you know, I won my first major event with that hand. But overall, I mean, aces is by far the moneymaker. And I guess there's a couple of people on our chat that don't like that wouldn't answer aces as their favorite hand. Yeah, you probably
five.
They're actually 24 solves wrong. It's four deuce off, I think.
No, so, he's got mine. Oh yeah.
Somebody had a question about the graph or the EV I was talking about. Does the graph take into account your opponents for the hands? No, it's just takes the actual hands. It doesn't matter who my opponents are.
Oh, or number of opponents or anything.
Yeah, it doesn't take into number of opponents. It's just how your hand matches up. equity wise versus one specific other hand when the money goes. That's basically it. And so, all right. So with that, let's. I just wanted to mention one more quick thing about the top three hands discussion. I remember something Doyle Brunson said, that he does prefer ace king to aces, which is kind of weird because he's the godfather of poker. I read this in Super System. I mean, I can kind of understand what his logic is, but it's still wrong. He says, yeah. I don't know if you know this is the reason why. Do you know why he said that, Joe? Why?
I would assume this is kind of like the old way of thinking. I don't know if this is true or what he thought about it, but the old guys would think, well, okay, I have aces and I have to go broke on any flop pretty much. Or, you know, and now if you have ace king, well, you can only go with it if you hit, and now, you know, and there's one less card for the other people to hit. You know what I mean? So
actually, you're right. He didn't really say you have to go broke with aces every time, but he said he prefers ace king because there's a better chance it's good when you hit, because it's one less card for your opponents on the flop to make a better hand with. So ace king, if you flop a pair, you're using up one of the three cards on the flop. So he says it's easier to play, plus it's less likely your opponents beat you. But if you have aces, there's an extra card out there and more combinations for your opponents to beat you on.
Yeah, exactly.
But I mean, I can understand that logic, but still, I mean.
But it's still wrong, I mean, for multiple reasons.
Right, ace is definitely the best hand, your biggest moneymaker no matter what. So with that, let's go to commercial and bring on Nick DiVella, who's a local live, used to be a former Rush poker player, very successful Rush poker player on Full Tilt.
Good live, no limit player too.
Yep. Okay, so right after commercial, we'll bring on Nick DiVella.
All right.
And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tehan.
All right, so today here we're with Nick DiVella. For people that don't know Nick, he's a very successful professional poker player. And obviously with our show, the running theme is we'll try to bring on successful pros, whether they're high profile or not. In the future, we'll get some... I'm not trying to knock you, Nick, but we'll get some higher profile guys on. No, but we're talking about cash games. Most successful cash game players are not well known. That's just because there's no coverage, you know, no publicity on cash game players. So, I mean, that just comes hand in hand. I mean, no one really knew who I was for a number of years, and I'm still relatively unknown, but I'm probably one of, you know, the more successful poker professionals around.
Who cares how many people know who you are?
No, it doesn't. You know, right? What I'm saying, it doesn't. But I'm introducing Nick here, and for those people that don't know him, he's, you know, you're a young guy, and you used to crush Rush Full Tilt Poker, the Rush games, the speed games. I don't know how to explain those, but I saw your graph, and you crushed it. And then after Black Friday, you converted to live poker, and you started off at 2-5, crushed 2-5, probably the biggest winner at 2-5, one of the top three biggest winners at 2-5 live games around town, jumped up to 5-10, crushed it, and now you're dabbling in 10-20. So, I mean, without a doubt, you've had tremendous success playing poker live and online. And I, you know, when the new friends introduced me to you, and then I mentioned you to Joe, I told him, you know, this guy reminds me a lot of me, not because we both crush poker, but you seem to go treat poker like a business and went about it the right way. So is my assessment pretty correct so far?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I really like your approach, Nick. I mean, it's pretty sharp. I think you were even more so than me. Like, I would go play just hours of poker whenever I felt like it. You know, some days I didn't feel like playing, and I mean, you had it down. Like, no, I have to go to work now, or like, you know, it's.
Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, I try to have a schedule, and
that's
stick
the other
to
thing
it.
Too. He's one of the very few professionals that just don't come and go and play whenever they want. He has like an hourly, goes play poker, what, like 5 p.m. to midnight.
I get to the casino between like 3 and 6, and you know, put in 4 to 8 hours or something.
Right, and then you take 2 days off every week, right? Was it like Sunday and Monday or Monday?
Let's see. Now it's Tuesday, Wednesday. It's when my girlfriend takes off work, so that's when I take off.
Right. Yeah. So yeah, like poker is like a business to you, really. It's not just, you're not like a typical degenerate poker player.
Right. I really hated when I used to wake up at 3 a.m. one day and 7 p.m. the next day. So,
I mean, how do you train yourself to do that? Most professional poker players, and I'm guilty of, and Jill's the same way. We just go whenever we want, leave whenever we want.
Well, I mean, I've changed that. I'm going like 9 to 5 every day now too, which I kind of like that. I mean, not every day, but you know, I've went from like totally unstructured and now it's structured, and I really like the structured hours, you know, like I have it now. It's so much better.
Right. I actually think I stick to it because of my girlfriend.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, if I mess it up with her, the schedule, anything, I'm in trouble.
So the old ball and chain already. Yeah. Okay, so I guess there's a common theme amongst us. I'm kind of the same way. I was really reckless when I was single. This is like decades ago, and running rampant around all the poker rooms. Used to play weird hours. But when I got hitched, yeah, I mean, I kind of fell into the same routine. And Jill, since you got married, the same thing. And Nick, you have a serious girlfriend. So I guess what we're trying to say is, if you want to do one poker, go get a girlfriend or significant other to set you right.
Yeah.
Admittedly, we probably all might have been similar degenerates like a lot of other guys had we not had someone to keep us in check. So speaking of your girlfriend, you guys just came back from a cruise, right? Did you hear the story, Joe?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, we went on a week-long Caribbean cruise to Jamaica, Key West, and Grand Cayman. And we didn't want to play any poker at all, but you know, one day we just couldn't help ourselves. So we jumped into a $150 tournament. There's only 7 of us who played, and it was winner take all. And it came down to me and my girlfriend. And
wow, shocker. Shocker. Let's see, some random cruise where, you know, none of them, it's not a poker cruise either. It's not like there's going to be some semi-decent poker player.
It was silly. But anyways, they wanted to play a cash game, so me and Kayla just went all in, and she got out on me, but we got a certificate towards a new cruise. I think this one's actually a poker cruise in October, and she gets to play in a $750 buy-in tournament, 100K guarantee. So
on a ship?
Yeah, it's October 28th. It goes to Montego Bay, Cozumel, and Grand Cayman again. So
that's a big buy-in tournament. That's a big tournament for
us. It's just like a satellite. Sounds
yeah,
like.
It's a sweet deal. I mean, there was $1,050 in the prize pool, and we got a certificate for $700 towards a new cruise plus the tournament buy-in.
Okay, oh, so wow. She like beat you heads up.
Yeah, she beat me heads up. We went all in on the next hand. So
I guess we got
cash
the wrong
game.
Person on the show today. Where's your girlfriend?
Yeah,
interviewing her. Okay, but back to poker. So now you play 5-10 and 10-20 around town. How are those games going?
Kind of hit or miss. Depends on the week at Aria. I play always at Aria. It's a bigger buy-in game opposed to Bellagio, where I used to play last year. But, you know, the days are a lot softer than the night games. All the grinders come out during nighttime, so.
Do you think the 10-20 games are infinitely tougher than 5-10 and then 5-10 versus 2-5? For people that are thinking about
it, I don't really think it's that much tougher. At 10-20, we do a lot of bum hunting, kind of wait for a big fish to come in town and play him. But then again, I've only played, you know, a handful of 10-20 sessions. I'm just now getting into it. But that's really the consensus. It doesn't really run too often unless there's a big whale, so, I guess.
Right. I know that about the games around Vegas. They're all like similar. You know, the skill difference between, like, the 2-5 and, like, 1-2 and 2-5 and 5-10, it's like, you know, there's a decent jump at each one, but not, like, anything crazy. But then, like, the 10-20 game will only go if, like, you know, some big fish is in the game or something.
Right. So those guys, I mean, I've played in those games as well. So basically, there'll be 2 bad players, 7-8 pros or semi-pros, pretty much.
Yeah.
You know, all the money comes from the bad players. 5-10 has a pretty good mix, right? So,
yeah.
But you think the biggest jump is between 2-5 and 5-10, Nick?
1-2 to 2-5 or 2-5 to 5-10. It depends where you play to. I mean, if you went from $1,000 buy-in at Aria 2.5 to Bellagio's $1,500 cap at 5.10. It's not that big of a jump, but you know, the money means less when it comes to expenses and whatnot at those levels. So I might say that 1.2 to 2.5 might be the biggest jump.
Okay. And I was talking to Joe about this, and I was mentioning to him how I think maybe this is taken the wrong way, but I was saying like the toughest place to play poker, and I told him that you said Vegas wasn't that tough, which I disagreed with. I was saying Vegas has the toughest games in the country.
Well, I guess I was considering all the variables that if it was any city that I'd like to play in, it had to be Vegas.
I mean, Vegas is the most convenient for sure, but I think when it comes to the games, like the games there, like lately, I just think the games there are pretty tough.
You're not going to get a big fish to come into town and punt off 20K, you know, every other weekend like you might at, I don't know, Commerce or anywhere else.
Well, it's not just that, but just the overall level of pros or people that play on a daily basis. Vegas is definitely the toughest if you just look at that. I don't know how many other areas you've played in around the country, Nick, but Joe and I have played everywhere. We've played in LA, Connecticut, Atlantic City, Vegas, wherever. I've played up in Seattle and Texas, and Joe's played in numerous other places traveling the circuit. And we would both probably say the games in Vegas are definitely the toughest on a daily basis just because you have so many pros here. On any given 2-5, 5-10 tables, you know, at least half the table will be pros or aspiring pros.
All right, we'll leave it at that, though.
I'm Vegas with you on
tough.
That.
Vegas is tough. We'll just leave it at that.
All right. Anyway, so let's get into some of the hands and stuff that you've played recently, Nick. Maybe we can talk about some 10, 20 hands.
Let's talk about these nines hands, Nick.
Well, let's get
this hand with the nines.
You want the nines first?
Yeah, here, I'll lay it out. I'll lay it out for everyone. This was a question on our forums at Stack'em. One guy posted a hand history where under the gun player, who I forget how he described him, like kind of a loose like calling station maybe.
He said massive calling
station. Yeah, massive calling
station. Massive calling station. Okay, so he has 1,100. He raises to $20 playing 2-5, no limit. And every player on the table called. And
stacks ranging from 300 to 1,000.
Yeah, everyone has about 300 to 1,000. And now he was in the small blind with pocket nines. And there was like almost $150 or something in the pot. Because everyone at the table called. So there was like a raise and 6-7 callers, whatever. And now he's in the small blind with pocket nines, and his question was, what do I do? And he had a $520 stack. So, I mean, a few guys got on there first. I didn't really say anything. Then I read some of the responses, and I was like, wow, you know, I was kind of surprised. Like, the guy that described the hand said he just called. I think he missed the flop and he check folded. And there were a lot of people that got on there.
Let me stop you there. Yeah,
okay, go ahead.
We didn't even see the flop. He was just asking, what do you do pre-flop?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the post-flop is not relevant right now.
Yeah, there
now.
Was no post-flop. So it's like, what do you do pre-flop? That was the question. So, you know, there were a lot of, like, most of the people early, you know, that responded said call. And then Nick also said he thought calling was probably slightly the better play, but I'm thinking about it and I'm like, well, I mean, I have the fifth best hand in hold'em or the sixth best hand in hold'em, whatever it is, like pocket nines. I mean, I think there's way too much dead money out there just to like call and try to hit a set. I mean, there's way too much dead money. So I'm like, well, I would just go all in for 520. That's what I would do.
I mean, personally. Nick, you have to understand where Joe's coming from. Joe thinks deuce four off looks really good.
I mean,
imagine when he has nines. It's going to look like aces to him.
Right. No, and I understand, but I just think we're a little too deep to make that play. I think if we had a stack of like 375, or maybe even if we had a hand like ace king or ace queen, you can stick it. I think nines might be a little too strong that we can still play a little poker. I mean, you have like three short stacks and three massive calling stations that have you covered that they're going to pay you off anyways on an eight high board.
The problem with nines, though, in the small blind is you're out of position, and position is so important in poker. And there's just a lot of bad. Even on an 8-high flop, sure, but even what if it's like 10-7 deuce? What are you going to do with 2-9s?
Okay, well then you check fold. You check fold. You see how the action goes. But we're already getting the right price to call. And I think people, if they want to read this hand, they can go to StackEm, go to the forums at the bottom of the page, and go to the 9-9 on small blind preflop to read everything. But I think what it comes down to is I want to ask Joe, what is your cutoff?
Cutoff for calling,
yeah.
No. Cutoff, like your cutoff stack. Like if you had a $600 stack, would you still shove?
I would probably. Up to like, I mean, if, you know, with the description of the table, it sounds like I'm only worried about one hand, like would be the end of the, like, is I maybe right. Under the gun plus one was loose too, but I mean, I'm only worried about one hand. So, I mean.
You mean one person, one player.
Yeah, like the under the gun guy, the guy that first raised preflop. I mean, he's the only
really.
Why can't
anybody behind flat with tens, jacks, or queens?
I was going to say the same.
I mean, they could. Maybe one and a half hands, like the guy in between, but I don't think, you know, maybe the under the gun raiser and maybe in the first caller, but like usually after that it's like no one has a better hand than nine.
Yeah, and I don't really know how to do the math on it. I tried to explain it in the forums, but I think you can just win more money by calling, hitting a set, and even if we don't hit a set, I still think we can win the hand. But still, I want to go back to, I think it really comes
but
down,
we're also going to lose the hand very often, like,
yeah, so we lose 20 bucks, right?
Yeah, but I just don't think you're making nearly. I think you're making a lot more, although it's a riskier play preflop. I think you're making a lot more in the long run because you're going to shove and take down 150 there, like, you know, like I think you even said 7 out of 10 times or something.
Yeah, I wrote it down. We're 7 out of 10 times.
Which I agree. I think it's somewhere around 7 out of 10 times when you shove all in. Maybe someone will call. Maybe someone not. But I think 7 out of 10 times you might take it down there. And when you do get called, it's like I don't think you're doing all that bad against the.
Well, I figured we'd be if we get called 2 times, we would be flipping, and if we get called the 10th time. We'd be crushed, and I wrote it down that we would have a profit of $850. Then I did it the other way, where if we call and hit a set, we would win $700, and then we still have eight. I did a trial out of 10 hands, and then with 8 hands left to go, I think we can squeeze out more than $150. If this is confusing to anybody else, they can go on and read it, but.
But you know, I don't think, you know, when you're winning this. Or, like, when you're flopping a set, I mean, are you really always winning 700? Are you always really going to win the pot? Your EV, even when you flop a set, isn't 100%. It's you're usually up against a flush draw or maybe, you know, it could be a cooler with, like, a two pair. But, like, but usually you're going to be up against a flush draw or something like that.
So
you're not going to average. You're not going to always, like, double up with that hand. You're just assuming you're always going to win the pot with nines.
No, I don't assume we're always going to double. I think long run, we're going to make whatever it is. I mean, yeah, there's times that we're going to flop a set on a 3-flush board, and the guy's going to have a flush, but we're going to get out on him.
Okay. Yeah,
so,
yeah.
So, I mean, those arguments can go both ways.
Okay, Joe, my question is, you like just shoving preflop? You don't like raising, say, to 150?
I originally thought maybe re-raise to like 200. I mean, 150 is not going to accomplish anything, really. I mean, if you probably raise to 150, you might get everyone to call again.
Yeah, I think like doing that. I mean, you're kind of asking for trouble. I mean,
yeah,
I think
if you re-raise to 150, like probably every player at the table is going to call another 120 more or 130 more or whatever. I mean,
so then 200 probably doesn't make much of a difference either, right?
Yeah, that's. I initially thought, well, I would maybe re-raise to like 250 or something, but then I'm like, well, that's kind of, you know, it's kind of doesn't really matter. Like, I would just shove it all in instead.
Right. So shoving allows you to avoid all those tricky spots if you make it 150, 200, and the flop comes like jack 10, 3.
Yeah.
No man's land with 300 behind, and there's, you know, if you get one or two callers, it's like.
Yeah, I thought shoving was the best
Yeah, and I would agree if we had like ace king, ace queen, nines I think are a little too strong. And again, like goes back to stack sizes. And I don't think you've answered the question yet. Where if you had like 650,
would you? I would still do it up to like, you know, maybe yeah, $600-$700 at least.
Okay.
And no, I think 700 is too much. I think there's three guys with 700 plus. I think that's too much. I think around 550, 600 is about the cutoff. I'm just estimating based on numbers. This is just comes down to mathematical game pretty much, actually. I mean, there's some metagame considerations, whatever, and post-flop skills, how well you play post-flop and how well you read other players. But I think in terms of equity, I kind of lean towards Joe and just like shoving pre-flop. The main reason being it just simplifies things. And, you know, just, and who doesn't like just like rolling the board out and just hoping your nines win?
Yeah.
Instead of having to see a flop, like tournament.
It's easier that way, too.
Yeah, poker is just easier to shove, get it online.
All right.
You guys are tournament mode.
Yeah.
No, we're not.
It's not even that.
Well, what do we do with ace king or ace queen? Nick, I think you kind of answered that. You said you would prefer to shove ace king.
Yeah. I'm all with you. I'm all with you for a 500, 600, 650 stack and just making life easier. You know, you can't really – I don't really like three betting there.
I don't know if it's fair to say that ace king or ace queen is easier to play than nines, though, because nines are very vulnerable to overcards post-flop.
Yeah, so, I think that's easy. I think it's easy fold then. It's just an easy check fold.
Okay, it's the same with ace king or ace queen. If you don't hit a pair – see, that's what I don't understand. Like, they're kind of in the same ballpark.
Well, it's only because nines are still playable post-flop. Ace-king is not playable on an 8-6-4 flop.
My reasoning is a little bit different. I agree with you that you should shove way more often with ace-king, ace-queen. But the reasoning being because at worst, you're usually going to be flipping. And sometimes you're going to have people dominate at calls with
ace-queen. All right. I think we beat this one to death, though. I mean,
Joe's ready to move on.
Yeah, shoving's the right play.
I can tell you some 10-20 hands. I got one for you if you want to jump.
All right, let's talk about a 10-20 hand you played recently.
Okay, so I opened to $80. It's 10-20 game at Aria. I opened to 80 under the gun plus 2 with queens. Cutoff, button call, both good players. And the small blind also completes. The small blind's the villain in the hand. He was an older gentleman who just sat down for an orbit. I've never seen him before. My image on him was that he was just standard old guy, you know, not really going to mess around. But then again, it's still 10-20. I still think he knows how to play the game. So the flop comes 5-4-4 with two diamonds.
What are stack sizes, Nick?
Yeah.
I believe I started the hand with just under 4K.
Okay. So 200 big blinds. Okay.
Right. Old guy checks.
And what the flop is?
5-4-4 with two diamonds.
Okay.
I don't remember if I had a queen of diamonds or not. So old guy checks. I C bet around $200. Cutoff folds. Good player on the button calls. And the old guy check raises to 820.
Well, how deep was he?
Well, 4K. It's just under. It's like 3,800 effective.
Okay, so 3,800 effective. Button and old guy, everybody.
Yeah. Okay. So what's the play?
Yeah, I mean, like, I don't know, I'll tell you what I would do, and it's probably going to be the wrong answer in this situation, because you're not telling the hand, but, I mean, I would probably just fold there. Yeah, I would just fold there. I mean, I'm not even going to call once and hope he shuts down or anything like that. Like, sometimes people do that, like, they'll call and, like, hope the guy shuts down. But, like, I don't know, playing too much live poker against too many old guys, I think it's like the old guys usually have trips there, which, I mean, in this case, it probably isn't the case, but that's my answer.
The thing. He called 80 out of the small blind, and I didn't know that this player would have a 4 in his hand. And I thought it was more likely that he would do it with jacks, tens, nines, or a flush draw.
Okay.
I think I should add that I was stuck 1100.
So I think we know where this is headed.
Yeah, yeah. I would have made a bad fold on the flop. That's going to be my name. Yeah,
like, obviously stuffed it in.
Yeah, I stuffed it, and there was another 3,000 to call. Button folded, and the old guy tank folded, so.
Oh, wow.
My answer would have been to fold, too. I'm going to be with Joe on this, too. We do disagree sometimes, but I agree, like, you know, old guys, they usually tend to have a nutted range more so than, like, a young guy does. So,
do you think stuffing is better than just calling?
When you call, you possibly let the good player on the button in cheap for whatever...
Another draw.
...thing he has.
Okay.
And then...
But, I mean...
And then you can still get pushed off on the turn. One, if he's bluffing with a draw or whatever, you know, if a ace peels off and he's got king, jack of diamonds and bets turn, then I have to fold or, you know.
Yeah, I mean, there's some bad cards that can kind of maybe scare you off your hand, but I'd be committed to go with, you know, 90% of the turn for sure, like, you know, maybe not. Somewhere around there. I'd be committed to go with most turn cards with 9.
What about clicking it back? That's a term you hear often these days, is CIB. It's clicking it back means, that's funny, it applies to live poker as well. Joe, you know about this, right? You know what clicking it back means, Nick?
Yeah.
Yes.
Just like kind of min-raising or making a small re-raise against the guy. Just kind of test him out, or, you know, you deal with the bluffing range plus value range also, just to kind of get him to spaz out, actually. I think that's the main goal of clicking it back most of the time, is to bluff cheap or to, like, raise small with your value hands and hoping he, like, spazzes out and shoves the rest of his stack.
Yeah, but if you do that and you call, you can't run it twice.
Oh, please.
That's just me being in debt. That's the
nittiness of. Oh, please. So you like to run it twice in big pots?
No, I really don't care. I mean, I'll do what anybody wants.
I mean, I always run it twice. I mean, why deal with the variance?
So why would you not, what do you think about just when he makes it 800, making it 1400? And then, you know, for some guys, they have another 2400 behind thinking, well, maybe I have enough fold equity, I can just jam.
You make 14 and the button jams. That would just be like...
Then I think you have to fold there.
Well, then you can fold, but I just don't like doing that either. I don't know.
So you like just the shove, just kind of... This is kind of the same terms as like the nines, just kind of make it simple and not have to think about...
Yeah, and maybe if you know, if I had like a $5,500 stack, clicking it back might be better.
Yeah. Okay. But
this $3,800 stack or whatever I had was kind of close.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't really like it. I mean, I would fold. I think folding is like normally the best play. Like in a spot like that, like, you know, in the future, like in a spot like that, and that's how like other people are. Like if someone's listening to this and that they come across a spot like that, like I think folding is the right play there.
Okay, well, the only thing I have is because he's in the small blind. It's like, if I raise under the gun and he calls under the gun plus one, I just don't see a four in his range.
Yeah, I mean, people surprise me with what single cards they can have in their range. I never really, like, rule anything out for anyone. I mean, he...
Nick's right about that.
He can have, like, a decent amount of fours, ace four suited, like 4-5, 4-6 suited, you know.
That's not under the gun plus one, under the gun plus two, like Nick said.
I mean, it's not like a tournament. Like, people go out to play cash games because they want to play some hands. So they get suited connectors.
My point is, yeah, they could have any two, but the frequency of them having those two goes way up when they're in the small big blind closing action. More so than right behind. So Nick is right.
No, Debbie's right. Debbie says, old guys want to see flops. I mean, it's like so, that's like so right. I mean, I couldn't have said it any better than that. Old guys want to see flops. I mean, how could you rule a four out of their hands?
Because if they're under the gun plus one or two, it just goes down. The probability of having a card with the four in it goes down.
It does
down.
Go down a little bit, but.
No, not
there,
a lot.
There you go, Joe. There you go, Joe. You see what that latest post was?
Yeah.
Old guys like the slow play.
Yeah, I'd I mean, it's obviously a tough spot, but it just comes down to your hand against the range of hands there, and you just felt like he could have a bunch of worse hands, Nick. That's why you stuffed it.
Yeah, I guess.
He was stuck.
I mean, another reason why I think we should fold the good player on the button, he could definitely have a hand that beats you too.
He could definitely, he's supposed to flat with trips and boats there.
So. Yeah, he's also supposed to flat there with eights and nines and tens and flush draws and 6-7.
Well, I understand that, but I'm just saying, heads up, it'd be a little easier, way more easier to stuff it, but when you're in the middle, I think that's enough of a reason to ultimately fold. Mm. So, but, I mean, it worked out for you, so. All right, so any other interesting 10-20 hands?
Off the top of my head, not really. I mean, I could probably make up some, but.
Okay, well, let's talk about this one other hand guy posted in our forum. Do you want to read it, Joe, or do you want me to read it?
Go for it.
All right, so it's 5-10 NL, 1K effective stacks, a fish with 1,200, considered a loose, weak gambling player, raises to $35, five people call. What's up with all these multi-way pots today? But
it's live poker. It's great.
I guess that's the difference. Yeah, I was just done playing a bunch of online. Every hand was heads up. Play online. But live, I guess you get 6-7-way callers. So five people call to him, our hero on the button. 7-8 of clubs. The flop comes ace-ace-9. I think this is a pretty good hand, especially for people that are trying to get better in poker. So the flop comes ace-ace-9, two clubs, so he flops a flush draw. Small blind bets 1,100. The fish, who is a pre-flop raiser, calls 1,100.
What?
1,100? Whoa.
Well, 110, I'm sorry. 110 at 11.
Like, that's a pretty big bet to be calling.
$110. the fish pre-flop, pre-flop raiser calls, and our hero on the button calls, and... Yeah, he has a flush draw, so turn is a three of spades, small blind checks, the fish bets 220, and our hero says, okay, this is just a mathematical problem now, right? So 700 in the pot, 220 to call, getting about 3.5 to 1, but needs better than 4 to 1 in order to get the right price. He also says this guy is never folding if he hits because he's a fish. So he calls. The river is the king of clubs. He makes a flush, but it's kind of dangerous. The board is ace-ace-9-3.
King-9-3.
All right. So this is where it gets interesting. The fish doesn't – or he talks and starts mumbling about the card. The fish does anyways. And said, if you got it, you got it. I'm all in. And our hero snap calls. And we can talk about all the mistakes he makes in hand. Well, let's do that first. Let's go backwards, because I want to mention the river, which is pretty obvious the fish has the nuts here. When someone starts mumbling, complaining about a card, and then shoves, if that's not the nuts, I don't know when it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I'm not big into live tells, but that's a very, very... big one.
I mean, it was just like, it can't be more transparent. They might as well just turn their hand face up and, I don't like that card, but whatever, I'm sticking it in anyways. And they might as well just show ace-king there or whatever.
Yeah.
So, but our hero snap called, which, you know, I'm sure we all don't like. I mean, he made his hand, so I guess he has to call.
Yeah. He made his hand, and now he's like, oh, man, he raised. What did I get myself into? But I still have to call. I have a flush. Like, all right. You know.
What do you guys think about our hero's line throughout this hand, or basically his calls?
I'm all for it up until the turn. One ten's a little too cheap. If he c-bet, like, 160 or something, I might let it go. But, you know, 110's just... too good to pass up, I think.
I kind of agree, and I mean, obviously proceed with caution. You're never trying to play a big pot in this spot. Like, I mean, you're never going to play like a very big pot, or you're hoping not to with your flush. You're hoping to maybe make a hand and win a small pot.
Yeah, I'm hoping to turn my club and make them pay for it big time on the turn.
Yeah, I agree. I think the flop is a call and the turn is a fold. One other big thing is he doesn't say mention is that he could already be drawing dead. I mean, he was already getting the wrong price. I mean, he even said he's only getting 3.5 to 1, but in these 4 to 1. But he's thinking the implied odds.
But if you turn a club, you're never gonna make him pay for it. Like, you're never gonna feel too confident with your hand, though. Yeah. You know what I mean, Nick? Like, it's you're never really hoping to play a big pot in that spot on an ace ace nine board with two clubs. Like, even if you make your hand, the guy could have had a higher flush draw, whatever. Like, he's probably gonna put you on a flush, so like he's probably just gonna check call one bet, like with trips or something, you know. I don't think you're ever going to win a very big pot, but I'm not saying like floating is wrong there. I would still call a bet in position for sure, but I'm just hoping like to somehow keep the pot small. And yeah, for sure, I think I'm done with the pot on the turn if I don't get there.
Yeah, I think there's a difference between there being two aces on board versus like two fours or two fives. Just because you're going to run into more full houses, you're going to be drawing dead way more often with two aces on board, because people always have ace-x in their hands also. But actually, why I wanted to discuss this hand is people fall into this trap too. Hands that look really good when you look at it, but they might not be that good. They look good in reality, but they might not be good in terms of equity. Like anyone that has a flush draw, amateur players tend to call way more often with straight draws, flush draws, than they should be doing, because they think they have a pretty looking hand. You have two diamonds in your hands, you see two diamonds on board, you think I have a flush draw, a call, right? So they don't think in terms of equity or whatnot. Another example, I can't remember who I was like, talking with, but somebody had a hand like 5-6 of diamonds, and the flop was like ace 3-4 with two diamonds. And it just went like four ways. People putting all their stacks in on the flop. And yeah, I mean the beginning type player will be like, well, I have a straight flush draw. How can I ever get away? And it looks really, really nice. You know, when you're sitting there with 5-6 of diamonds and the 3-4 of diamonds out there, like how can you ever fold, right? But I mean, I think we all realize when you have like 3-4 guys putting in 100 BB stacks, how good is your 5-6 of diamonds there? Right. How much equity do you think we have?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good point. Like, people don't realize, like, one guy could just have a big flush draw and someone else can have, you know, you're going to be up against, like, either a made straight or a set or whatever where you'd either have to hit your open ender or you'd have to hit your flush card. And a lot of times your flush card's not even good. So, I mean, but I'm just saying, if the 3-4 diamonds is on the board, I mean, how are you ever going to fold that? That's a horrible example.
No, that's not a horrible example, Joe. I think that's definitely a fold.
I mean, if it was like ace 3 diamonds, just that little percent difference.
No, I think, say 4 guys put in their stacks besides 5-handed, and it goes raise, 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 and 4 guys are putting in, say, 2-5 or putting in 500. You're really going to call it 5-6 of diamonds?
No, because
there you go.
I know, but I'm just saying, like, if you got a straight flush.
You're falling for that trap, like, ooh, this hand looks so pretty. 3-4.
When the 3-4 diamonds is out there, it's such a huge difference.
Yeah, but your equity is probably, like, less than 10%
it's like,
overall.
Yeah, like 2% difference.
Yeah, because there's going to be a set out there, and there's going to be the nut flush out there. And you're pretty much, you know, you can hit a flush, and, you know, there's so many ways to lose. Yeah,
I typed this into the calculator. If we're 5 ways on a 9-4-3 2 diamond board with aces, kings, a set of threes, king high diamonds, and we have 5-6 diamonds, we're actually 27.5% to win the hand.
Oh, yeah.
No, but you're just assuming people have ace kings.
Well, what else you want them to have?
I mean, somebody else could have.
Like ace 3-4, in that example.
They have like deuce 5 in like one of the blinds.
Yeah, they can have straights like already and stuff. I mean, it's still like, I don't think it's that bad of a call. Like, people kind of think of it mentally, they'd be like, well, why would I put my money in if I'm only like 27%? Like, but if you're 4 ways with 27%, like, people don't realize that that's a profitable call, and that's a call they should be making. Like, no one ever says, well, I don't want to why would I want to put in 200 or however much extra it is? Like, why would I want to put in all this extra money when I only have 27% chance of getting it back? And the answer is because there's like four people out there, and like that's all you can do in poker is like get your money in with like a positive return. That, you know, positive like expected return. That's all you can do. Like, people sometimes get upset about, you know, they give me bad beat stories and I'm like, well, what was wrong? You got it in ahead and you lost, and they just don't get it. Like, you know, I mean, if you get it in with 27% return, you know, it's obviously a good call.
How much was that deuce for off equity, Joe?
I mean, yeah, that was big, dude.
Okay. I'm just joking. I'm always going to joke about that. Well, people in the chat joke about that deuce for off, so.
I don't know.
All right. Well, on that note, we'll wrap up the show. Thanks a lot for joining us, Nick.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, yeah. And you can follow each of us on Twitter. I'm Nicolak Poker. Joe's Joe Tehan. At Joe Tehan. Nick, what's your Twitter handle?
My name, Nick DiVella.
Okay, at Nick DiVella. And as usual, you guys can email us at john@stackemcoaching.com or joetpoker@gmail.com for any questions or poker questions you guys may have. And thanks for listening in. This is Cash Plays brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker and use promo code QuadJacks82 for a free day trial. Thanks again, guys.
All right, thanks.
See you guys.